Welcome in, everyone, to a very special episode of the David Hookstead Show. Today, we have Bob Keller, former Delta Force Commando and a shooting instructor, joining us. Thank you, Bob, for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So right off the bat, you and I have something very in common. You're a Red Dawn fan. I'm a huge Red Dawn fan. So could you speak to a little bit about your love of the film Red Dawn and how that kind of shaped your views of gunfights and stuff?
I don't know, man. I mean, I was young when that first came out. So when I watched it, just the type of person or type of kid I was, that was just something I loved to do. I liked to go out in the woods and stay out in the woods by myself. So when I watched that movie, I was like, yes, this is like, I could do this. Like I literally wish that would happen my whole childhood.
Oh, that's really badass. Wait, isn't it? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I mean, probably not the best thing to wish for, but I mean, literally, like, as a kid, I wanted that to happen. I had a blowout bag. I had a way to get out of my basement bedroom and then make it up to, we had acreage, and I had a bunch of woods beyond the acreage. So I had forts all over the place. Like, I had a plan to, if that ever happened, you know, what I was going to do. Well, stupid things you think about when you're a kid, you know?
Well, the reason I bring it up is when I was about six, I had a little BB gun and I watched that movie probably way too young, but I would run around pretending to kill communists. And then when I was 8 or 9, I got a Ruger 10/22 from my dad. And then, you know, we'd shoot the 22 pretending to shoot invaders. Same thing. I dreamed of paratroopers dropping from the sky. And when you look back at it, you're like, that's kind of fucked up, but when you said that, I was like, I got to find this guy's email. I got to get him on the show.
That's so awesome.
What was your journey then to the military? How did you go from being the kid playing in the woods with the blow up bag to being a Delta Force commando? What was that path?
I mean, it's kind of a weird one. So I played hockey and golf my whole childhood growing up. And those are the two sports I kind of picked to be good at or pursue. Did that through high school. I actually moved down to Florida after high school and picked golf. Like I thought I was going to move down to Florida as an 18-year-old kid and make millions of dollars playing golf. That didn't happen. I did end up playing professionally on the golf tour, which was like mini tours. But I did do that and did that for a couple of years, and it was no shit. Like the whole, just that Red Dawn shit, right? Like as a kid, just living out in the woods, like wanting to do that and wanting to shoot. That was always inside me. It just, that wasn't like my family, I guess my family's path, you know, like they really didn't do a lot of that stuff. So I think it was either in Mississippi or Louisiana. Missed the cut on one of the tournaments. And I was like, what the fuck am I doing? Like I had the option to either drive the next tournament or go back home. And I was like, this is stupid. I'm playing golf, not because I love it, but because I want to make money doing it. You know, there was no passion there. So I made the decision. I drove back to Florida and like, I think it was either the next day or 2 days after I was at the recruiters joining the military.
Like, and did you tell them right away? Like, hey, I want to be special forces. Yeah. I want to get gunfights.
Yeah. And I mean, this was pre 9/11, but I had talked to a couple of people on the golf course, surprisingly. I think it was a female that I was playing with at one point. Her brother was a ranger. So I kind of knew that you could go the ranger path. So when I drove down or back to Florida and went to the recruiters, I was like, hey, I walked in there because I was 24 years old. So I was a little bit smarter than most 17 and 18 year olds going in there. I was like, I want a ranger contract or nothing. You can, you know, you're either going to give me a ranger contract or I'm out. And they hooked me up with a ranger contract. So I went right from basic to airborne, right into ranger time. And then from there, that all shifted to ending up at the unit. And that was because after 9/11, when I finally had the chance to deploy my first time and actually get into my first gunfights, I realized real quick, kind of like I realized golf wasn't my passion. Well, that first gunfight I was in, I realized that was my life. Like that is what I was meant to do. So then after that, it's like, where can you go to get more gunfights? And that's what led me to the unit.
So the first time bullets came your direction, what was going through your head other than this is what I'm meant to do? But do you remember like the specific thoughts as you heard them whizzing by and you're shooting back what you were thinking the first time?
Yeah, like I won the lottery. Like literally, I mean, it sounds weird to most people, but that was the best day of my life. Like that was stuff as a kid you dream of, right? And then, I mean, how many kids have dreams growing up and then ever be able to fulfill them? Well, that was one of them. And I mean, if 9/11 would have never kicked off, I would have never had the opportunity to do that. I mean, not many people do get to experience that. So I like my first reaction, no shit in my head, was like, I had won the lottery. I couldn't run to the gunfire fast enough.
And were your other team? So you're an Army Ranger at this time, or correct me if I'm wrong.
This was SF days.
Okay. So were the other guys on your team and that specific team just like you, where they're like, hey, we live to get in shootouts? Were they kind of looking at you like, man, this guy might love this just a little bit too much?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that was going on a little bit. And for the rest of the deployment, I think at one point they were nicknaming me the cowboy, you know, or whatever. I mean, they were like, I was too eager to go to the gunfire. And I think for some people, I mean, that's going to piss them off. Right. I mean, cause they're your teammate. They're going to go with you.
Right.
You know? So, and I'll straight up admit that first deployment and maybe even my second, third deployment, I was fucking stupid. Like instead of thinking about it and doing things smart, it was like I wanted to be, or I had to be the first one there.
Can you give us an example of something you did in a firefight looking back? You're like, that specifically was a real dumbass decision.
Well, I think it was like the first time, like getting shot at from a distance and then without hesitation running towards the gunfire by myself with no one behind me. When we had Humvees that we could have gotten and you know, up armored Humvees that we could have gotten into, hell no, I'm fucking running through the desert going towards the gunfire. I didn't even know where they were at. So stupid shit. But it was like, that's if you dream of that your whole life, or that's what you want. I mean, it's like, you don't want to miss the opportunity.
Right. Were there guys you served with before you saw combat that they thought maybe, hey, I'm similar to Bob. Like I dream of this. And then when the time comes, they're like, never mind. Not my thing. I actually don't enjoy getting shot at.
Yeah, not anyone I know or worked with, but I know that has been a thing, which there's nothing wrong with it at all. I mean,
right.
No one can, if they've never been in a gunfight, you will not know. You could dream about it your whole life, think you're a badass, train for it your whole life. No one is going to know if they like it or not until that first time, you know, bullets are screaming by their face. That's when you realize if you like it or not. And that's the only way that you'll know. And I know of people that you would think, holy shit, like this guy's fucking badass, right? And then when it actually happened, they didn't like it. Which there's nothing wrong with that. Like I would never look down at someone that says, you know what, this isn't for me. Because for some people, it's just not.
Right. No, absolutely. If bullets are flying past your face, it's a totally rational thing to be like, I don't want to be doing this, right? But for you, you're like, hey, I want more of this. I'm going to go to Delta. Yeah. So yeah. You go to selection, you go through the process of getting into Delta. Was there anything that really kind of surprised you or was unexpected, or were you pretty much prepared when you rolled in? This is what I trained for. This is what I want to do.
I think which most people wouldn't think this would be a surprise. I think the surprising thing for me when I actually got there was like I was ready to, because no one, like especially back then, no one knew about the place, including myself. So like you actually make it through and you get there and you're thinking, all right, I'm gonna I'm gonna be top like the ninja shit, like stuff that no one's ever fucking thought of, right? And it was literally going back to the basics of the basics Like, that was surprising to me. I thought it would be immediately shooting from helicopters, shooting from cars, doing all this freaking high speed shit. No, it was going back to the absolute basics of shooting, which, I mean, now I look back at it, that is 100% how it should be. But like, that was surprising to me. And I think people that I work with, that going through the training, like nightly, we'd come back and be like, what the fuck? Like, why aren't we doing fucking, like, we already know how to do this stuff, right? So I can't, like, everything else surprising, like on a, like on training or what I had to do, I was never surprised on that. My surprise was going back to the basics, you know, being at the, I would say, the greatest show on earth, the best of the best. And then when you start off, even though you're, a lot of guys are coming from Ranger Battalion, SF, the SEALs, Air Force guys, like we're already shit hot, right? Like, you'd think you'd just go right into doing some badass shit. No, you go back to day one shit, which was fucking awesome.
I have some questions that we're going to get into later with your shooting instruction about the basics, because I've heard you say some things I find very interesting. But with the guys on Delta, now you're in a place with, like you just said, the best of the best of the best. Did most of them have your mindset of, I live for this shit, like, this is my passion? Is that kind of how you have to be at that level?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's why it was such a great opportunity and a great place to work. When you have guys that you're going on target with that are all like-minded, they want to be there, right? There is no fear. They like, I mean, it's, when you go to a hit, it is literally a fucking race to see who can get there first. Well, that, you know how exhilarating that is to be with 20 or 30 fucking dudes that don't fucking care if they get shot? Like, it's the greatest feeling ever. And it's almost addicting. And that's why you want to just keep acquiring fucking targets, because, I mean, you're with a bunch of dudes that are not only the best of the best on shooting and tactics, but they all want to be there. Yeah. I pretty fucking cool situation to be in.
I can't even imagine. It sounds so unbelievably awesome. Well, did you did you spend most of your time then in Iraq?
I would say, well, yeah, most of my deployments were Iraq. I think I had 5 or 6. Well, it might have been 6 or 7 in Afghanistan.
And when you are doing, you know, you're on the helicopters, you're in the Humvees, and you're going to a raid, and like you just said, you got 20 or 30 guys. They all want to be here. They're amped up. Do you feel, before you even get off the vehicle, before you even fire that first shot, there is no force on God's green earth that is stopping us? Who's ever in that house, we are going to kick the living shit out of them.
Yep. That's the mindset every shooter should have, like LE guys, agency guys, home defense, and anyone who holds a gun for protection. I mean, that should be the mindset. Unfortunately, it's not. So to be going on target with that, like there, that is not only the mindset, but it's, I think it's straight up true, but I mean, like you 100% believe that is the case. Like you're the fucking baddest motherfuckers coming in. There's no one going to be there to stop you. I mean, people that get shot over there, I mean, it's straight up luck. I mean, because they're most of the guys shooting at you aren't aiming,
right?
So, but yeah, that is what you're feeling when you're going in. Like, for one, no fear, but everyone on that helicopter knows that they're the baddest motherfucker out there.
One of the things I'm always curious by when I interview special forces guys, SEALs, or whatever, and they talk about combat, is kind of the human element. And I've always get a range of answers. I'm curious to hear what you said. When you get into these firefights, when you do these raids, when you're taking out the bad guys, is there an element that you're like, oh, you know, that could be someone's son or that could be someone's father? Or is it more like, fuck them? They would drill holes in our skull. They kill innocent people. Who gives a shit? They're bad guys. Or do you kind of, is there a human element, or is it just, no, fuck them, let's kill them?
I think I, well, yeah, don't. probably sound like a fucking asshole by saying that. No, I never thought that once. That never entered my head. And I mean, most of the guys I work with did not think about that. I have talked to people that, you know, had contemplated that or thought of that. But me personally, never entered my brain. And I will never look back and say, oh shit, like that might've been someone's freaking dad, you know?
Well, look, and I agree. And I've never been in the military, but I'm fascinated by military history. The reason I ask that is because we have people in the media and college students on college campuses. And when they talk about like terrorists, they try to like humanize the atrocities. Like, oh, they're not that bad. You need to understand. And I'm like,
that's bullshit. What are they trying to do to us?
Right. Exactly. You know,
like, why would I feel sorry for someone while I'm coming in on infill and the birds, and I'm getting RPGs thrown at me and freaking rounds thrown at me? Like, they're trying to kill us. Like, so yeah, I would never feel, I never felt sorry for anyone on target ever.
Right. Are there any moments when you look back at your career that stand out as like maybe the one or two moments that you'll be telling these stories forever, is like, that was such an unbelievably cool thing that you can talk about? I'm sure a lot of it's classified, but is there anything that you can talk about where you look back and you'll always say, I cannot believe how awesome that was?
Yeah, well, definitely. I have one, and I've said, so people that are listening that have already heard this, it's repeat, because the one that does stick out to me. So when we go on target, we're a force, right? I mean, there's guys with you. Like, so there's, I mean, I would say 50, 60 targets where there's been multiple dudes like in a compound running around shooting at us and we're shooting at them. But you always have a team with you or two teams with you. So there was one time where I laddered up on the wall, and there just happened to be one ladder on the wall. So I was the only one up there. Other teams were on other walls in the compound, but they couldn't see what was going on. So I was up on the wall, and I just got lucky as hell where I was at in that compound. I was the only one who could see. Like, no one else could take shots or anything. And it just all hell broke loose. And so I got very, very seldom do you get to even make your own kill, but like individually, because we're all so good that everyone's so fast. If there's a bad guy, we're all shooting, right?
Right.
So, and then it's even more seldom to get a chance to shoot multiple dudes by yourself. So I was on the wall, all hell broke loose. I had like, I think it was five dudes in the compound that were, I mean, I had RPGs coming at me. I had grenades being thrown at me from the left, RPG coming at me from the front. I had small arms coming at me. I'm the only one of them up on this wall. And I got to engage all those targets by myself. And it was not only, it was good for like training, because up until then, multiple targets by yourself, it was always like the rhythm drill or cadence drill. And I remember, like, I mean, to this day, and it's good as an instructor, I can like now bring this to civilians, like better ways to train. I remember on the wall by myself shooting these dudes, thinking the fucking way that I've been training multiple targets is fucking totally wrong. Like, rhythm drill and cadence drill is not a thing, because you can only shoot one guy, like, you know, you kill one guy at a time, right? And that's what it was. So it was cool for that on the train side. The funny thing was on it, because everyone wants to get some. So like for some reason, we only had one ladder. And like, while I was shooting, you could like, I don't know if I saw them or I just heard them underneath me. They were all like, what the fuck is going on? Like, I'm just getting it on right on the wall. No one else was getting any play. So they were scrambling to get fucking ladders. The other teams were trying to come over the wall that I was at. But that would, like, if I was to pick out any hit that I'd been on, that would have been the one that stands out, because I actually got to engage multiple threats by myself with no help.
And
it just never happens.
Was that in Iraq or Afghanistan?
That was Afghanistan.
That is absolutely wild. When you guys come back from a mission, or maybe you're back in the U.S. after deployment, is it kind of like how, you know, athletes, they kind of one up each other, right? When they're like, yeah, you threw three touchdowns, but I threw two and I rushed for two. Do you guys like get into debates over like who did the most badass shit?
Yep. Absolutely. It's usually the new guys, you know, cause they, I'm telling you, it is the greatest show on earth. Like we get to pick targets that we know we're going to like either take contact at, or it's going to be a big target. So it's all, so they're finally getting their shot to like get in real good gunfights, you know, and it's always the newer guys that are coming in. They're like, man, you know, did you see me do this? Did you see me do that? And it's always the guys that have like multiple deployments with the, you know, they're like, man, we all fucking did the same thing, you know? And they're like, oh, well, we were the first though. You know? Yeah. We talk about it all the time. I mean, it's funny to hear the perspective of the newer guys that are just getting there compared to the guys that are seasoned, that have been there a while. It's just it becomes just an everyday occurrence. I mean, we're going on target sometimes three times a day.
Three times a day?
Which is fucking just insane. Yeah.
And did you have a problem with that? Or you're like, hey, there's a fourth and a fifth option. Let's go hit more targets today.
For me and most of the guys I work with, yeah, it's I like to if you were you in college?
When what? 9/11 happened?
No, like did you go to college?
Oh yeah, I went to college. I went to the university.
Was there ever a time where there was like your buddies were going out to a party, you didn't really want to go, but they were all going, and then you're like, fuck, I'm gonna go because it might be the best fucking party ever.
Right, you don't like,
want to miss it, right? Because you didn't want to miss out on like the best fucking thing. Well, that's how gunfights work. Like you never wanted, whenever you heard another team going out and getting a good gunfight, you're fucking jealous. Like you were like, God damn it. So you wanted to go out constantly because you're always looking for the best party. You know, you're always looking for the next best gunfight.
So on the flip side of that, were there any instances that you can recall or discuss where things maybe got a little hairy, a little worse? You thought you're like, this is getting real fucking dicey. I don't know if we're going to be able to just slide right out of this one.
Not me. I had guys that got pinned down in front of a door. This would be a good one to have some of my teammates on. I think we did discuss this in one podcast. These guys had gone up to make breach. And before they got there, it was like on the front door of the house, and all of a sudden the door opened and there was a dude with a PKM in the hallway shooting out the front door. And it wasn't like a full team. It was guys that were going up and there just happened to be like this little burn right in front of the door. So this guy just opens up. Well, these guys get pinned down like literally like 20 yards from the front door in this little teeny burn. So you got like five guys trying to huddle in to this berm, and this is the funny shit that goes on. So none of us, we all want to be there, right? Like no one's ever scared to get shot. No one's ever scared to fucking die. So like that, now they're pinned down in front of this door with this PKM. There's nowhere to go. If they get out, the guy opens up, you're fucking dead. So like all the other teams, I was on the left side. There was another team over on the right side. We're trying to provide, you know, cover for him, but there really was nowhere to go. So the whole time we're on the comms, like we're all laughing at him, like, yeah, just fucking sit there, hold on. You know, like most people are like, holy shit, like I'm gonna fucking die. No, it's like dudes are like, oh shit, this is a good one, like this is a good one, I'm fucked, you know. But that actually happens more times than none. I mean, you'll hear, like, we're always giving each other shit on the radio. Like, if someone gets pinned down or something, instead of being like, oh, man, don't worry, you know, you're not going to fucking die. It's like, we'll literally be laughing at them. And they'll be laughing back saying, yeah, just fucking hurry up, you know.
That's an unbelievable level of confidence. But I it's awesome, though. That's the type of stuff you can't make up. So to that point about that example you just gave, do plans, how often the times does the plan go perfectly? And then how often does it go out the window as soon as you guys open up on people?
Yeah, so I would say 98% of the times, usually the plan goes and I wouldn't say goes to shit, but it's never how you plan it before you launch. You know, like you have a plan, like where are you gonna land? That usually always happens unless you take contact going in. But like what target you're gonna go to, what door you're gonna go to, that always mixes up. And then like once the first rounds fucking crack off, everything, and I wouldn't say it doesn't go to shit, but it doesn't go as planned. You always have to, what's the NFL or what's the
audible?
Like an audible. I mean, you're doing that constantly on target, which makes it, I think, even more fun, right? You're doing something that's not part of the plan. You got to fucking figure shit out. I think that's what makes a good operator. Like, and that's why what we're looking for is not only the best shooters and athletic dudes. We're looking for people that can fucking think, because that happens. I can't say where it was at, but there was one of the off the books missions, like the one fucking time I can think. It was over in another country I can't fucking talk about. It fucking literally went down 100% how as planned. Like one fucking mission out of, I've been on over 1,000 hits.
1,000 hits.
Yep. Only one time I can think of it, like literally from start to finish, it went exactly how it was fucking planned.
That is well, that's the fact that only one out of 1,000 is crazy. The fact you've been on 1,000 hits in and of itself is also insane. I'm curious about the training, because we were talking about Iraq, Afghanistan. You were in the military for a long time. How did you see training evolve pre-9/11, post-9/11, and then you got the insurgency in Iraq? Were there a lot of shifts, or was it kind of holding steady that whole time?
There's some tactics that shifted, which I can't talk about those. It's not even that big of a deal. But I think the biggest deal, and that's the reason why I teach the way I teach, and the way that I, like my last five or six, maybe probably even fucking longer than that, of being operational, how I switched training. I think the biggest lessons learned when you actually finally get to do real gunfights, you realize, like pre-9/11, not many people have been in gunfights, right? Including myself. So when you go train, you're training for how is a gunfight going to be. So you're setting up scenarios, you're setting up situations, right? Because you're not as focused on the shooting, you're focused on like, how's a fucking gunfight going to be, right? I'm going to set up all these crazy fucking scenarios on the range. Well, then after you've been in a couple of gunfights, you start realizing every gunfight you're in is always different. The situation is never the same. So I've been in hundreds of gunfights. Not one of them has been fucking similar. They've always been different. So when you start realizing that, like situational and scenario based training, you can't train for, because you never know how it's going to be. But you're constant in a gunfight, and this is where the simplicity of fucking gunfighting and shooting comes down to. You're constant in a gunfight is bringing the gun up, getting sight picture, pull the trigger, to make shots, right? So pre-9/11, it was always setting up, at least for me, setting up scenarios, running a gun and doing all this fucking crazy shit on the range. And like, and that was like 90% of my training. That like 10% of it was the actual shooting. Because I was like, okay, I know how to fucking shoot. I'm going to train for situations. Totally fucking revamped the way that I train, the way that I teach. After it was probably five or six gunfights into it, when I realized, it was like, goddamn, situations are always different. But the one thing that was always constant, every gunfight I was in, I always had to bring the gun up, no matter if it was pistol or rifle. I always had to get sight picture, and I always had to pull the trigger. Like that is literally what you should be training on. Cause all the other shit is always going to change.
Right.
So when it comes down to instruction, I mean, I am a boring fucking guy. I'm not one of those fucking badass instructors having you do all this crazy fucking shit. You know, like it is literally fucking shooting. It's bringing the gun up, getting sight picture, pulling the trigger. How fast can you fucking do that to save your life? But that's literally what it is on target.
Well, and one of the things you're big on, as we referenced early in the interview, is the basics. And can you explain to our viewers who maybe they don't own guns, they're not shooters, why it's way more important to just be great at the fundamentals and great at the basics more than like the Instagram, like I'm going to do this cool shit to post on Instagram. Like what you stress the basics hard. And could you talk about that?
It goes right back to what I was just saying. Train for your constant, you know, like, because if you're doing all the cool stuff that looks cool on videos, and that's what you're spending your time on the range, you're wasting time doing the thing that you know has to happen, which is bringing the gun up, getting sight pictures, pull the trigger. It's fucking boring shit, but that is what wins gunfights. How fast can you actually drive that gun up to target and get sight pictures so you can pull the trigger? Like all the other, so like to answer your question, that's what it is everyone wants to do the cool stuff that looks cool on videos, but when you're doing that on the range, you're wasting fucking time. Like, I still beat, I'm 48 years old, I'm fat and overweight, right? Compared to when I was operational, but I'll still outrun guys in drills because I can still shoot. Like it's not how fast you are on your feet. It's not the Hondo rolls or the fucking cheetah flips that you're doing. Like that means nothing. It's shots on fucking target and keeping your gun on target so you can do faster follow on shots. That's what wins. And that's what wins on gunfights. It's just not sexy shit.
Right.
And I think a lot of instructors out there are doing the sexy shit because they know it sells, which I could care less. I mean, I don't do classes. I don't instruct really for the follow-on students. It's literally, I actually do this to fucking help people, you know? So like, I don't care if people don't think it's sexy. I don't care if people are like, when they leave the class, like, oh, that was the coolest fucking class. I do it to fucking hopefully save fucking lives.
Well, I when researching this interview, I saw a YouTube video where you made some comment, I'm paraphrasing, you're like, you know, I don't have a big scary beard.
Yeah.
I don't have all the tattoos, but you're like, that doesn't save you in a gunfight. Like a beard's not beard's not bulletproof. That's not going to stop you from getting hit. And that's why I wanted to talk about the basics, because that video, which I think was a few years old, even, is so good and blunt. But it, with your training, what's a mistake you see often from first time or kind of entry level shooters? They don't even know they're making it, but what's a common mistake that you often catch people doing?
Shit. That's a good question on like the biggest thing. I would say actually the biggest thing people that haven't shot with me that don't think is an important thing is the reacquire the target. So like, they go to the range, they shoot, like right when the pistol comes up, right when the rifle comes out, right when they shoot, they immediately go back to the holster or come back down. Like no one knows the importance of reacquiring the target. And all the reacquire is after you take the shot, you're keeping the gun up for another sight picture, regardless if you're going to take another shot or not.
Right.
Because most people just go to the range. They only go to the range. That's all they know. Well, if you do thousands of reps of every time coming up on target, taking the shot, and then coming back down immediately, good chance that's what's going to happen in a gunfight. I've actually seen it.
Well, and it goes back to kind of the cadence drill thing too, right? Like shooting something twice and just moving on doesn't guarantee anything.
It's bad muscle memory. Yep.
Have you, in your training days now, have you ever had instances where someone comes to the range and they think they're Rambo 2.0 and you might not say it, but you're thinking this dude is an effing idiot and has no idea what he's talking about?
I'm actually asked that a lot from students and from like people like yourself. I am very fortunate and lucky. I don't know if people know who I am or they watch videos. I have not had that.
Wow.
I've heard horror stories of other instructors. Like when you get that guy that knows everything, or he's that guy that he is the fucking Rambo dude. And like, this is how it's supposed to be. I mean, knock on wood, I have yet to have a fucking student like that. I've been very fucking lucky.
Well, no, that's good. It's a surprising answer, because you think you move enough people through a class, you're eventually going to meet one person who's a bit of a dickhead. If you could only have one gun, Okay, you're only allowed to, Bob Keller can only have one gun for the rest of his life. What gun are you choosing and why?
Oh God. You're gonna make me answer that when I have, when I, well, it would be my rifle for one. I have a signature rifle with SOT. And not because it's my rifle. I mean, it is set up exactly the way that I would want to go to war. That's why I came up with it. And I'm a rifle guy. I mean, gotcha. I run staccato pistols. They're fucking absolutely the best pistol out there. But if I was gonna, if I had to pick one, it'd always be a fucking rifle.
Right.
And if if I had to pick a rifle, it's gonna be the one that I actually set up for fucking war.
Well, it's this wasn't even on my list of questions. I didn't know that you were selling, that you had your own rifle. So my apologies. Poor research on my assistant's part. I'm just kidding. But then I'm guessing that if you are selling your own line, and obviously you're a shooting instructor, you must clearly be not a big fan of like restricting access and trampling on the Second Amendment. Is that a fair statement?
Oh yeah, it's absolutely it is ridiculous, and it's getting worse. I mean, it's somehow we need to fucking stop.
No, I agree with you. You're talking to the right audience. Our audience is big believers in the Second Amendment. I can't stand that shit whatsoever. All right, I have a few. These are kind of more of the fun, laid back current events questions. When you're in Delta, you're, you know, tip of the spear, top of the ladder. What's your interaction like with like regular, just rank and file soldiers when you're on deployment? I mean, are you kept to yourselves? I mean, how does that work? Because you guys are doing these high risk jobs on a regular basis. Do you have much interaction with regular soldiers?
No, not much at all. There's been a couple times I can think of that we actually use them for, I wouldn't say QRF, which is quick reaction force, but maybe like on the admin side. I think on the aircraft side, we've used non like soft guys, but like we, Everywhere we go overseas, we usually have our own compound, right? We are our own element. And besides going to like the fucking chow hall, like you don't see anyone. And we're so fucking busy anyhow. We usually have our own gym and shit. Like besides literally the chow hall, you don't ever see any non-soft guys.
And does being in a tier one unit and in such an elite environment, doing what you're doing all those hits, what is that? How does that impact the family structure back home? I mean, is that difficult to deal with? Do you learn to deal with it? How does that all work?
Yeah, that's a good question. I should bring my wife in for that one. it is freaking hard. I think I didn't realize how hard it was for like my wife. And then now looking back on all the other wives, like we're going over, like everyone always thanks us or thanks me or thanks people that I work with. Like, oh, thanks for your service. Like I literally every deployment, I was like, it was like going to Disneyland for me for free.
Yeah. It's like,
right. Yeah. I mean, like I'm getting to do what I love to do, but everyone thinks, oh, it's so hard to go overseas. No, it's not for us. It's not hard. We're going to a playground, but no one ever thinks about the wives at home that didn't sign up for this. Like right. I signed up for it because I wanted to get in the shit. My wife didn't sign up for that. So, I mean, my wife has been with me. So I went on 14 deployments and she's been with me from day one. Like to put up with that for 14 deployments with me getting to go do what I get to, you know, like love to do. Well, she's sitting back there taking care of the kids, taking care of the dogs. She's mowing the grass. She's doing like paying the bills. And I'm over there not dealing with anything except for doing what I love to do. So I think I'm glad you asked that. I think most of the thanks should go to the family that's staying at home. Cause like there's times, that's why she should be in here. I mean, there was a time where, like my buddy got shot, right? He's like really good family friend, got shot right in front of me. I didn't even call her. Like to us, he's fine. But like, I didn't think anything of it. All right. Fucking, he got shot. He's banned. You know, we sent him, he went to fucking Germany or whatever. Like, it didn't even cross my mind to call her and say that something happened. Well, she had got a phone call from his wife saying that he'd been shot without a phone call from me. So now she's thinking, holy fuck, like what just happened that night without knowing? So like the next time when I talked to her, she's like, yeah, did anything happen, you know, last night? And I'm, I was like, I don't know, you know, so-and-so got shot, but whatever. But we don't look at it like a big deal.
Right.
That's a huge thing for them. They're sitting at home every single night or every single day that we're deployed waiting for someone to come to their front door. Like it's kind of shitty. So when I finally got out and was talking to her about that, I kind of felt fucking bad. Like you're absolutely right. You're the ones who are fucking worrying. We're getting over it. We're going over and playing a fucking game, you know?
Well, it sounds like she's an incredible woman. I mean, I can't imagine.
She's badass.
She sounds badass. Did she chew your ass out pretty bad on the phone over not telling her?
Yeah. Which again, I was like, what's the big deal? People get shot all the time, right? You know, it's like, he's not fucking dead.
Right. That's an interesting, two different viewpoints of the same issue treated two very, very different ways. So I don't know if you, do you follow the news a lot? Do you watch a lot of news?
Recently, because of the COVID bullshit, I have stopped watching because I'll break my fucking TV.
Well, hold on. Let's stop there. Go on. What are your thoughts about COVID?
It's a fucking flu, right? I mean, I don't even, it was probably made up in the first place, but I think it is a thing, but it's, I don't agree with how, I mean, it's straight up a fucking, it's a media ploy for, I would say, Big Pharma. Well, they're making fucking millions right now, right? For what? For a fucking flu that we've, like the swine flu or the bird flu back in the day. Like, why wasn't that publicized? Why don't we have a fucking pandemic for that?
Does it surprise you how many? So I live in Washington, D.C. We've been under essentially lockdown since early 2020.
I'm sorry for you.
Yeah, it's like it's a borderline prison. I was surprised by how many people just asked no questions. They just put the mask on. They stayed home for a year and a half, and they don't even want to go back to normal. To them, this is better. Like they think this is the way.
It's insane. So they're literally just going to wear a mask for the rest of their lives.
Yeah. And they're never going to leave.
I don't. Well, the problem is actually I guarantee these motherfuckers that are wearing masks all day and agree with it. If tomorrow fucking ABC came out and said, everything's fucking fine, you don't need to wear a mask, they wouldn't wear a mask.
Well,
like they'd be fine with it. They listen to the fucking media. I mean, that is the absolute problem.
Do you think there's an issue to the point you just made about just listening to what you're told of like, shouldn't you question like authority? Shouldn't you question the government a little bit? Like, wasn't that kind of the whole spirit of America? Like, we're just not going to roll over for everyone.
I question everything. And that is the problem with most people. They don't, you know, they don't want to think for themselves. They just want to be told what to do. Like, I am not that fucking person. I haven't played this game since day one. I didn't publicize this in social media or anything, but I have from day one, me and my family have not fucking, we're not bought into it. We haven't fucking played the game from day one.
Well, good for you. That, you know, it'd be nice if in the prison city of Washington, D.C., we could get a little more of that attitude and spirit. Speaking of current events, I want to get your take on what's going on with Ukraine and Russia. Two questions, but the first one is, do you think there's any chance that this is actually going to turn into a real war with Russia and Ukraine, or do you think this is all just hype?
That's a good question. I don't know, because I think Putin could go either way. I don't know. I know why he might do it, like what he can gain from it. why we're involved and why we care, I don't know. Like, what are we gaining from Ukraine is what I'd like to know. I'm not that savvy in that, but like, we're the world police, right? That's just how America seems to be. I don't agree that. Why do we care what he's going to do?
Right.
Is my stance like everything that we've fucking done? It's like, why do we get our noses in everyone's business?
So if Biden were to send over troops to Ukraine, you'd be like, that's not it. Why are we doing that?
I think it'd be a waste of money. But when you're looking 15, 20 years ago, I'd have been all for it because that would have been my chance to hopefully get another fucking conflict, right?
Yeah, it could have been another shootout for you.
But I don't know. I guess I need to be more educated in that. I don't know what we have to gain from getting into Ukraine and Russia business.
So this is the second question. There's a rumor that has caught a lot of traction on social media. And it's alleged, and people are retweeting this, they're spreading around, that the U.S. Special Forces and Russian Special Forces, actually, I'm not kidding, I'm not making this up, this has become a very popular theory on Twitter, have worked together extensively in the past, killing bad guys in different countries. I have no reason to believe that's true. You seem like you possibly would know if it is. Have you, from your experience, ever worked with Russian troops at all?
Fuck no.
That's what I thought. Okay, thank you. I made a point to ask that. I said, this is the dumbest fucking conspiracy.
Who is saying that?
I don't want to say it. It's someone rather famous started it. I don't want to say their name.
No shit. But not even fucking close.
Yeah, that we run joint missions, killing the same people, and it got a ton of traction because of what's going on in Ukraine. I'm like, there's no fucking way that's true. There's no way that's true. All right, here's a fun one. If you could go back in time and be at any major military event, what's one where you're like, man, I wish I could have seen that one?
Besides movies and shit, maybe it would either be World War II or fucking Vietnam. You know, like being like an SF guy in Vietnam, or just a regular fucking troop dude in World War II. Like that's the shit as a kid. Like, again, it goes back to what we started this off on. Like, I would watch movies of World War II and be like, I would think most people are like, oh, that's terrible. Like, that's a terrible fucking situation. Like, I would watch movies and be like, yeah, that's what I fucking want. You know,
sounds
and then
awesome.
Vietnam, you know, when you're looking at like how SF was the force multiplier, they go in, you know, work with a big group, but a small team. Like, that was the shit that, like, I literally would be like, that is badass. You know, jungle now, stuff I know now, like, what I want to work in the jungle, like that's some shitty ass fucking terrain to fucking work in. It would either be World War II or Vietnam.
I actually had a family member that was a long range recon ranger in Vietnam. They wrote a book about him and a bunch of guys. I don't know much about it. I'm not an expert on it, but to your point about the shitty terrain and just the insanity of what that must have been in Vietnam, I can't even imagine. Imagine.
Crazy. I mean, their uniforms would literally fall off them.
Right. And wasn't the original M16, didn't that thing just jam constantly in the jungle terrain? Like, it was a disaster, wasn't it?
Yeah, disaster. Yep.
So kind of touching on something that we got into previously, when you hear people who maybe are younger college students, you turn on the TV and you hear people making excuses for our enemies, making excuses for the Taliban, sympathizing with terrorist organizations, sympathizing with ISIS. For example, there'd be idiots that would go on TV and say, well, you just need to understand them a little bit more. What does Bob Keller hear when he sees people, 21-year-olds, talking about how we just don't understand the terrorists?
I mean, the only thing I think of is they're fucking ignorant. they only know what they know, and it's either being taught to them from their teachers. They're all usually left side people. They're being influenced by the wrong people, is what it is, and they don't know any better, and that probably comes down to freaking shitty parenting. And then they go to school and they don't know any better. Now they're being influenced by another fucking adult that's the teacher. They're gonna think this is how it is. They don't. It's kind of what we say earlier, having your own fucking thoughts and thinking about it. They don't. Like, they're going off of what their other students are saying and what the fucking teachers are saying, but they don't, they literally don't even know the fucking situation.
Right.
I agree with protests, like dudes fucking protesting. They don't even know what they're protesting for.
Right.
Because everyone else is doing it.
Right. No, I agree with you. I agree. I think it's complete ignorance. I'm 29. So I was only in college like 7 years ago. I remember some of the shit I'd hear kids say. It was just mind-boggling. It was like they're almost living in an alternate reality. Like, they just don't have any idea what's going on.
No idea.
All right. If your phone rang right now and they said, Bob, we need you back. One last mission. Are you going or not?
Fuck yeah, I'll go. Yeah, I wouldn't want to go, like, deployment-wise. I'm done with that. So I got lucky. I was always at the right place at the right time to rack up those hits and have those deployments and have the good deployments. I have had my fill. I could die tomorrow and have no regrets on. I think a lot of people, like, some people get out early and then they're going to think, wow, but what about, like, I could have done one more hit and it could have been the best one. Like, I'll never have that regret. I think I have fucking seen a lot of shit. I don't think I could ever see a better gunfight than what I've seen. So, like, yeah, if it was like, hey, Bob, you're going to go on a 6-month deployment or 4-month deployment, I'd probably be like, yeah, fuck you. But if it was like, hey, we need it for one hit, I can't. I'm there. I can't.
You're running towards it. All right. I asked this question to everyone in the military I interview, and it's only pissed one person off. Delta versus SEAL Team 6. Who's better and why?
Well, who are you asking?
Well, I'm asking you.
Other unit guys, or are you asking?
I've asked that to other Delta Force guys, multiple Navy SEALs, Marine, Ranger.
I wish I would have listened to some of the interviews then to know what they said.
Well, here, I'll tell you this. The guy that shot Bin Laden, Rob O'Neill, I asked him that question. And he was very diplomatic with it. He had nothing but high praise for Delta Force. And in fact, his exact quote was, they fought like motherfuckers in Iraq when they hit the ground. So he kind of said it'd be a split. He thought it was, he wouldn't say anything bad. He praised the hell out of you guys. But what's your answer? Explain why Delta is better than SEAL Team 6.
Well, I mean, no one wants to piss each other off because we're all a fucking team, right?
I get it. Yep.
I would think if they truly were fucking thinking of this by themselves and just not saying it to someone else, they're going to agree we're the best. I mean, it is because the individual, I think the reason why we're better is we have a better selection process. And I think our age difference is a lot different than theirs. And we, instead of just grabbing your fucking guns, getting a helicopter and going, like, we actually think about things. Not that they don't either, but I think we're more meticulous on who we're going to go after and when we're going to go after it, right? Instead of just being like the whole, everyone always kids about the SEALs being with the movies and freaking, you know, the TV shows and the books and stuff. When you're at the unit, like, you're not thinking of that. I mean, you're actually thinking of success. You're thinking about doing things the right way. You're not thinking about the the glory of it, or the book side of it, or the movie side of it. Not that all of them are doing that. But I would say we're better just because we think a little bit more before going on target.
Well, that's a very fair answer. That was a diplomatic answer as well.
But it's funny though. It is. So to be fair about it and kind of diplomatic about it, it all comes down to individual troops and the individual teams. So you might have one troop on one side way better than a troop on the other side, but then you also have another troop over here that's way better than a troop over here. It all comes down to your leadership and the dudes that are underneath the leadership telling them, you know, how things should be done. So I think it could go either way, depending on the team or the troop or the squadron.
When they got Bin Laden, were the Delta guys like, what the hell?
We were pissed.
I've always wanted that.
That kid, yeah, there was people that wanted to quit. Trust me. I mean that I'll talk to you offline on that. It was like that was a fucking sore subject. How that all went down, I'm not gonna explain it on here, but it to me, end state on why it was the fair thing to do for them to do it. But there's a lot more that went into it.
We can leave it at that. We don't need to start a civil war here between
exactly.
Us. But the reason I brought it up, so this is 100% true story. This happened in a room full of people. I asked that question to a guy outside of an interview. He's a former Navy SEAL. This happened about 3 years ago. Okay, packed room of people. I asked him in a joking way, SEAL Team 6, Delta Force. I shit you not, and I've said this publicly in other interviews, this guy looked like he was ready to fight. Like I had insulted him so much by even asking the question. And I saw that same guy about a year later, and he was still pissed about it. I mean, he held like a grudge. Every other Navy SEAL, they laugh about it. You know, they debate it.
And so would we.
This guy was so unbelievably pissed. It would blow your mind.
No shit. Really? I'll say this. I have never met any of those guys because I was on a water team. I'd go over there and like pick their brains on shit because we're not water guys, right?
Right.
And I have literally not met one of those guys that I didn't think was a fucking squirt away dude. I'll say that, you know. There's not one guy that I ever met that was like, oh, this dude's a fucking turd. So.
Well, hey, that's good. We're the United States of America, our military, field, whatever.
We're all part of the same team, right?
Right. We're all fighting for the same goal, yep. In and outside the military. All right, final question. If they made a movie about your life, who do you want to play you?
God damn. I mean, it'd have to be me.
So you're going to – that is the best answer I've ever heard. That is a great answer.
Yeah, you can't. You can't. I wouldn't be. No one's gonna be able to play me. Let's do it.
That is awesome. Well, Robert, thanks for joining me today. This has been, without a doubt, one of the most fun interviews I've ever done. I love your openness. I love your vibe. It's been great.
Hey, thanks for having me on again.